Thomas asks a question that's kind of come up before, but let's go, and he even mentions that. But I recently heard you mention that the cost to benefit ratio of swinging a bell over 24 kilos should be carefully considered. But Thomas, I think every exercise you do adding load, you should take a moment and go, you know, is this going to help me capture my goals? Is this part of what I need to do? Now, listen, I love putting lots of weight on the bar. I think it's a great value to it. But at the same time, you have to, you know, like I said, say a lot. You got to fold your arms, nod a little bit, and say, is this worth it? And when it comes to loading kettlebell ballistics, this is a question that comes up a lot. My question is, how strong does one need to be? What are your standards for an average guy trying to stay strong and healthy in terms of strength and fitness? Thinking of exercises such as clean and press, double front squat, goblet swing. Should I aim for heavier bells than 24s, or should I focus on other aspects of training such as increasing VO2 max, improving mobility, or something else? I should reach a certain level with my kettlebells. Yeah, the answer is yes. To all that, you should try to improve everything all the time. It's hard to do. If you go online, I know I have it in my books for sure. The Armor Building Complex has a real big section on it. I think Easy Strength has it. I know my older books have it. But if you can find it online, it's my old site that doesn't really exist anymore, but it's on the Wayback Machine. And I call them Sleepless in Seattle Standards. And Paul Isingo shared with me a whole bunch of numbers that'll help you on your fitness journey. You know, when I talk to people about the Armor Building Complex, Thomas, one of the things I say, you know, if you can do double 24s every minute on the minute for 30 minutes, and that the Armor Building Complex is two double kettlebell cleans, one double kettlebell press, and three double kettlebell front squats. If you can do them with the 24s, for 30 minutes, every minute on the minute, I consider you're doing okay, you know. When it comes to the clean and press, you know, I would still get myself back to the 1954 standards of Bosco. I mean, I would love to see you, you know, every one of my listeners be able to clean and press double 24s. As you get stronger, double 32s, double 36s, double 40s, double 48s. Once you get to double 48s on a clean and press, I think you're starting to get yourself in position there. It's time to really shift over to the barbell. When kettlebells became extremely popular in the late aughts, so 2007, 2008, and 2009, a whole bunch of people from the barbell world started coming over to the kettlebell world. And it was really interesting because a lot of the standards that kettlebell only people had were easily achievable by someone with a barbell background. Now, you know, if you do the Secret Service snatch test, at least the way it was explained to me, where you do the 200 reps in the snatch with the 24 kilo in 10 minutes, I mean, that's real, you need preparation for that. So when we go to the clean and press, I think, you know, just double your way up to happiness. 24s, 28s, 32s, 36s, 40s, 44s, 48s. When you say the double kettlebell front squat, the standard on that, again, I think I'm going back to Sleepless in Seattle standards right here, but if you're an adult male and you can do double 24s for the double kettlebell front squat for 10 reps, you probably have locked and loaded. You know, you're in good shape. You're doing fine. With the goblet squat, you know, that's all over the place. Generally, I'd say, you know, for most of our listeners, if you can do the 32K for 10, yeah, you're fine. Especially if you drop down, you push your knees wide with your elbows, stand up. Squat down, push your knees wide with your elbows, stand up. You know, so there's a minor pause at the bottom. On the swing, let me just throw this one at you for no fun, just because it's easy. I mean, can you do the 10,000 swing challenge with the 24, you know, 20 workouts of 500 swings a day? I mean, if you can do that, you've probably done enough swings the rest of your life. He asks this in this, this final question I've already read, but should I aim for heavier bells in the 24s, or should I focus on other aspects of training, such as increasing VO2 max, improving mobility, or something else after you reach those levels? One of the things I always think, Thomas, is that once you've achieved like a good strength goal and you spent some time getting up to it, I like the idea of really switching gears and going into another direction. I was lucky when I went, this is going to sound weird, but when I picked up that liver parasite in the Middle East, you know, I just didn't have, I could have lifted weights, but it was really hard for me. I just didn't feel good. So I started getting into these things called sprint triathlons. They weren't very hard. They were the ones I raced in. I doubt they even run these anymore, but it was a quarter mile pool swim followed by, oh gosh, I want to say a 30 mile bike ride and then a 10K run. Later they shifted it to 5K runs, and I just think that gave the bicyclist every advantage. But one of the things I noticed after, it took me probably a year, year and a half, maybe a little longer, to get myself feeling good enough to throw weights over my head again. 2 years easy. But what I noticed is that after doing those more cardio-ish, longer bike runs and swims and runs, when I came back, and obviously up here, I could go longer because, you know, going on a 100-mile bike ride, you know, that's a long time to sit in a chair, sit in a seat. Swimming, you know, is obviously expands your ability to tolerate, no offense to swimmers, but boredom in a pool. So anytime you lift weights for a while and you get some strength goals, I think it's a good idea to try something else. For example, I mentioned that the 200 snatches in 20 with the 24 in 10 minutes. Say you get this, say you pass all the standards of the armor building formula in my book, okay? Well, after that, why don't you stop doing kettlebell clean and presses and presses and focus on the kettlebell snatch for a while, because that will help, at least from what I've been told, will help with your VO2 max. VO2 max, of course, is one of the hardest things to pin down because it is hyper specific. Much more than you would be led to believe. I don't want to get into those studies back 20 and 30 years ago when they would say these elite athletes were just, well, let me just summarize it this way. They were testing elite athletes, their VO2 maxes, on bicycles. But elite athletes are often really tall, really long, and some elite athletes didn't grow up in a bicycle culture. So you're testing someone's VO2 max on a piece of equipment they don't understand, or well, they don't have a lot of background with. You know, if we took some of the most elite long distance runners in the world and had them test their VO2 max in a swimming pool, especially those who don't know how to swim, you would get really interesting results from that study. I think we've gotten better about all that. But I love the idea of switching up that way. So my thought for you, get some, you know, get those strength goals, chase a snatch goal, you know, the RKC snatch test, 5 minutes with 100 pounds, with five minutes, 100 reps with the 24. Get that, chase another strength goal, chase another snatch goal. Constantly keep trying to change things just enough that keeps your mind, body, soul, and spirit interested. Okay, interesting question, and thank you.